Moses said, "Whom shall I say has sent me?" The Lord said, "Tell them I am." Yeah, Yahweh. That wonderful, mysterious name, that powerful, that glorious name means God manifesting his existence in activity. Thank God we have an active God. Hallelujah. And thank God that Yahweh became flesh as Jehovah, Yahweh the Savior. And he's here tonight by the Holy Spirit. This wonderful atmosphere of praise and worship and expectancy. I'm going to ask our brother Derek Williams to come and pray. We have two urgent prayer requests. A Betty Taylor in Derbyshire goes into hospital for major heart surgery tomorrow. We're asked to pray that the Lord will undertake. Please pray for Alan, that's all the name I have, of Bangor in Northern Ireland, for healing. Unspecified the nature of his need, but the great physician not only diagnoses, he delivers. Amen. He's one who manifests his existence by doing things for us. Sure, there are other requests. A sister in the nearby assembly, Towin, lost her dear husband just very, very recently. There are those who are mourning tonight because of terrorist activities. Brother Derek, come and bring these needs before the Lord. Thank you.
Precious Jesus. What a wonderful name. The name of Jesus. That name that's as ointment poured forth. Healing, strengthening, satisfying, life imparting, demon conquering name. Hallelujah. The name of Jesus. The name above every name. And this evening, we dare to believe for miracles. For Jesus is amongst us in all his might and power. Hallelujah. Oh, we thank you that the confidence we have is in the name of Jesus. Oh, we thank you for the joy of sins forgiven. We thank you for the glorious knowledge of the blood of Jesus Christ that cleanses from every sin. We thank you for the healing that's in the finished work. Hallelujah. And oh, we thank you that it's with confidence we can lay hands upon these names this evening. You know them. We only know them by name on paper, but you know them personally. And we pray that it might be said, he sent his word and healed. For that dear one going into hospital, minister to her, we pray now, in the name of Jesus. That young man, Alan, in the name of the risen Savior, all that healing shall be his portion. Those who are mourning, those who have been hurt through these terrorist acts, Lord, we pray, show your compassion, show your mercy and love, and minister. We thank you that we are found here this evening in the courts where we rejoice in the goodness of our God. We thank you. Oh, hallelujah. We thank you that we can be called brethren, and we know the joy and the thrill of fellowship together, the joy of worship, the joy of celebrating. And now as we come a little later around your word, we believe that our brother Wynne is going to know an anointing from on high. He's going to know that word that shall be good for our hearts, ourselves, our fellowship, that we might say God has ministered amongst us, manifested himself amongst us. Thank you for all your goodness so far upon this camp and upon every celebration. And yet we can say the end is not yet. Praise the Lord. We believe that you're going to minister this evening. There are those dear ones that have come with needs, heaviness of heart, those that are seeking direction. We believe that this evening and this week, you are going to minister to them. So as we believe you have prepared our brother to minister, we believe that now you are preparing our hearts to receive, that we might hear the voice of the Almighty amongst us. We ask it in the name of our lovely Jesus.
You may be seated, friends. Thank you, Brother Derek. I have
One or two notices for you. First of all, if you're a late comer to the meeting, you should have been in the other one. But let me welcome you once again in the name of the Lord. I have to announce that at 11 p.m. tonight in the Snowdonia Bar, there is an any questions time with a very illustrious panel. Well, at least three of them are illustrious. Mavis Jarvis, Steve Ritchie, Dave Cave, and someone called David Allen. First time for a long while I've been given my Sunday name. That's in the Snowdonia Bar. You're invited to be in the audience of that question time. I'm not wearing a bow tie because I'm not the chairman. Also, I have a notice from the CIA team. There is a difference. Between 2 p.m. and 4 p.m. on Thursday, the CIA team and many children will be washing cars all over the camp. Please sponsor these children who come to you, as the total amount collected will be given to the PCCA. So if you would like your car washed, then don't turn them away. Let them wash your car and sponsor them. I can't think of a better cause. I think the last notice that I have is that we'd like you to visit the display. Now, this is not pay and display. It's display and then pray. But there are displays over there and also in the corridor leading to the other venue. We urge you to go and look at those interesting and exciting displays. I'm sure the Lord will speak to you through those. And indeed, we're hoping that he will speak to you in this meeting as has been prayed. I'm going to ask John Morgan now to come and read to us the Word of God before we sing again and then give time and attention to God's Word. Thank you, John.
I've been asked to read Psalm 23. This is a favorite psalm of many, many people. It's good to know the shepherd's psalm. It's even better to know the shepherd. Hallelujah. Psalm 23. The Lord is my shepherd. I shall not be in want. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside quiet waters. He restores my soul. He guides me in paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. For you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup overflows. Surely goodness and love will follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord. What? Forever. Amen.
Thank you, John. Now we're all going to sing together before we have the Word of God brought to us by Wynne Lewis. We're going to sing number 221. We believe in God the Father, maker of the universe. Wasn't a big bang, you know. God created everything. And in Christ, his Son, our Savior, come to us by virgin birth. We believe he died to save us, bore our sins, was crucified. Then from death he rose victorious, ascended to the Father's side. Now, I like the second verse. This is a charismatic credo. We believe he sends his Spirit on his church with gifts of power. I was reading Dr. Torrey the other day, and he said, God gives the Holy Spirit not to make you happy, not to make you holy, but to make you above all useful. God make us useful by the power of his Spirit. Thank you, Russell.
Thank you.
You may be seated. Welcome, Wynne. The Lord bless you as you minister God's word.
Well, good evening. Hello? Don't switch the tape on yet, will you? Is this thing working? Can I get rid of this? Thank you. Well, nobody said a word anyway, so...
Gone on this thing? That's better. Good. Well, I bring you greetings from our conference, which ended yesterday. And we kicked off our conference with the Assemblies of God pastor, David Shearman. And we had a great opening night a week last Saturday. I'm thrilled to be here tonight. Now, just before I start preaching, that's why I say don't roll the tape yet, because you might not like what I'm going to say. I wouldn't like it to be used against me. Do you have nightmares? Well, I had one the other night, and I had a nightmare that, you know, I've just had an operation. They cleared four of my lanes in my heart, put four bypasses in, and just before that, I dreamt that I'd gone to heaven. And I thought, dear Lord, I hope it's not true. And not just yet. I'm not one of these Christians. There are always some Christians that drive you around the bend. They're always wanting to go home until they have a heart attack. Then they want to live. And I believe that God has given me a job to do down here. Until then, my friends, I get on with it and not dream of my beautiful mansion up there. We'll put up with the little alien one we have down here. Anyway, I knocked on the pearly gates, and obviously Peter came out, and he said, "Who are you?" I said, "Wynne Lewis, Welshman, more to the point, with Elim." Well... He says, "That's an advantage to start with." "Born again," he says, "that's okay, but," he says, "you can't come in here yet." I said, "Why?" "Well," he says, "we have a test. I want to know whether you've lived a good life. And we have a field over here, and it's full of mud, and I want you to walk across this field of mud, and I'll be watching you, and if you sink down deep, I'll know that you have been a secret sinner. That will reveal your heart, not your pulpit manner." And I thought, "Oh, well, that's all right." And so I began to walk, and I was amazed that after I'd gone a couple of hundred yards, I'd sunk down to my ankles. And I thought, "Dear Lord, I haven't been that bad." And I was getting worried. Another half to go. And then I was catching up with a fellow. I couldn't recognize who he was from behind. And he had sunk down to his hips. And I thought, "Who is he?" And when I got abreast of him and looked around, it was Colin Whittaker. I thought, "Bless my soul, the editor of Redemption." And he's down to his hips. I thought I was bad. And I said, "Colin, I know that you used to cheat when you played against us at cricket in Luton, but I didn't think you were that bad." And he said, "Listen, Wynne," he says, "I would be a lot worse off if I wasn't standing on Albert Garner's shoulders." I reckon we're one all now. He was at our conference, was it 2 years ago, 3 years ago? It seems eternity, I know, but I mean, it was a memorable visit in spite of that. Well, that's good. Now you can start the tape. One of the hardest jobs in the Christian ministry is to convince people that God wants to use them. Come to think of it, when you relate your own life to the Lord, that was the greatest stumbling block to ministry in my life. Long before I believed that God wanted to use me, God had decreed in the councils of eternity that it would be so. I can understand why God wanted to use Billy Graham, Smith Wigglesworth, the Jeffries brothers, the Carter brothers, Donald G. You see, I didn't know them and their weaknesses, their emotional framework. But I know me, and I know all my weaknesses. I know my frailty. I know my background. I know how I wrestled with inferiority complex. And so I don't know. And I find it difficult to understand why God should want to use me. I've got two texts tonight in the book of Acts in chapter 13. The first one is in verse 22, and the second one is in verse 36. Acts 13, verse 22, and verse 36. After removing Saul, he made David their king. He testified concerning him, "I have found David, son of Jesse, a man after my own heart. He will do everything I want him to do." Mind you, he did a couple of things God didn't want him to do. But of which of us tonight could God say, from the moment we came into his kingdom, that we have done everything that God wanted us to do in life? I try to do as much as possible, but this man has this testimony, and I am not a theologian, and I have a galaxy of them here tonight. I better watch what I say. I do know that on three occasions God testified publicly about human beings in the Bible. He said of Caleb, "I like him. He has a different spirit to the others." And he says of David, "I have found him to be a man after my own heart. He will do everything I want him to do." And then his dear son at his baptism, "This is my beloved son with whom I am well pleased." Would that God could testify tonight. We testify, but what if God decided tonight to have a testimony meeting after this service, and he began with each of us, and I wonder how many of us could he pick out and say, "Here is the man, and here is the woman, here's the young person, since they gave their life to me, they have done 100% of all I ever wanted them to do." Verse 36, David served God's purpose in his own generation. David served the purposes of God for his own generation. I don't know why God wants to use me. And so often in our churches, our Pentecostal churches, when a slight indication comes to men and women, "I am choosing you," we begin to excuse ourselves instantly. "Lord, how can you use poor little me?" Like Gideon, we are glorious deluxe nobodies. Nobody in our church, you say, is a better nobody than I am. I am the best nobody in our church. I won the gold medal at the Nobody's Olympics. Therefore, God, please, I pray, have me excused. I am exempt from your service. I'm not fit. I haven't got the personality. I don't have the gift of the gab. Now, these texts in Acts 13 have gripped me for years. Everything What a testimony. Nothing that I wanted him to do has been left undone. He has done everything. It's almost on a par with the Lord Jesus. In Mark 7, we have that unsolicited witness of a vast company of people. He has done all things well. I can remember back to my school days, and there were some brainy ones in my class. There were some duds too. Most of my time in school, I just had Wisden's Book of Cricket underneath. Couldn't care less about x squared minus y squared over f squared or any squared. What in the world had that got to do with cricket? Geometry. Who cared when King Harold lost his eye or anything? I didn't. When did Dennis Compton score 30 centuries in a season? Far more exciting. And therefore, when it came to the examinations, I'm glad that in those days they didn't post your report home. They gave you a buff envelope. I'm glad also in those days they didn't put the marks down. They graded you A, excellent, G, good, S, satisfactory, F, failure. I tell you, didn't take much ingenuity, just a kettle boiling on the Bunsen burner to steam the envelope open. An array of ink pots matched the teacher's colors. I wasn't saved in those days. And my mother thought, there's not a boy in our village to match my boy. All A's. Little did she realize it was with the aid of a little bit of ink. But there was one lad in that class, he didn't need to climb up to the physics lab and resort to such shenanigans and chicanery as some of us did. He was brilliant. Today, he is one of Britain's leading atomic scientists. You could give him the most profound equation, and without writing it down, he could work it all out in his brain. Brilliant. But he had a weakness. He could not spell. Most things, brilliant, a weakness. Our Lord, all things well. David, God said, he has done everything I wanted him to do. I want to live my life like that. I want to be so burned out for God, not just talk about it and sing about it, but my whole being dedicated to God. When you came into the world, the neighbors must have thought, especially if you are number 5, 6, 7, or 8, there's another accident. And indeed, you may have been a biological accident, but not according to God. When you came into the world, when I came into the world, God showed the angels, this is my blueprint for that baby. When our Lord stood before that grand inquisitor, the Roman governor, he could say, for this purpose came I into the world. Do you remember in his last week on earth, our Lord going to that meal in that house in Bethany? And when it was all over, when the slave should come in and wash the guests' feet, Mary got in before the slave. She had something in her hand. The Bible says it was worth a year's wages. Just imagine tonight if you had at home not that cheap little junky stuff that glorified dish water that your husband brought home and said, my, this is Chanel number 59, the newest one they have out. Imagine that in your home tonight, you wouldn't have it at home, you'd have locked it up in the bank, that you had a bottle of perfume that's worth £15,000. That's the equivalent today, the national industrial average. Costly. I don't know how it came into her family. It may have been handed down from generation to generation. It doesn't matter how she got it, but she had something that was invaluable. She could have used it on herself, a dab here and a dab there. And everybody in Bethany said, my, that's Mary going by again. She could have shared it with her friend. She could have sold it to the highest bidder and made herself comfortable all her life. Or she could have squandered it selfishly on herself. But when she poured that ointment on our Lord and Judas Iscariot led, oh, this is fearful, isn't it? The most outstanding act of magnanimity in the New Testament is criticized by the leaders of the church. Why this waste? And the Lord said, don't criticize her. Then he came out with something profound. It was intended. The Lord had put super glue on that lid, not to be used for any common purpose. That will be used on my son. Others anointed Jesus, but anointed his corpse. Too late. But Mary had grasped the significance of the hour, and she was saying, Lord, you've known me as a worshiper and as a gazer. Now I'm going to prove my love to you. And she poured it all on him. And our Lord says, it was intended. However she got it, God preserved that bottle. It was intended for Jesus. And I want to say to you tonight, my friends, you may be a bank manager, you may be a school teacher, you may be whatever you want, well, whatever you are. But if God, when you came into the world, if God said he or she is intended for my work, then you better oil your skates and do something about it. There are so many in Pentecostal churches twiddling their thumbs and doing meaningless things in the church, shuffling paper clips, meaningless mumbo jumbo, when they came into the world, God said to the angel, it is intended that he or she should give their lives totally for me and for my work. And you're here tonight. And I want to say to you that before this night is over, you will have poured your life at Jesus' feet like Mary did with this ointment. Now, let's look at David. Because every time you challenge people to give their lives to God's work, they say, well, you see, I'm not blessed. I'm not advantaged like the people who are really making it. What a lot of nonsense. David wasn't born with a silver spoon in his mouth. The other day, when I was preparing this message, the Lord impressed me to read all the Davidic Psalms. Here's a young shepherd boy. He's nothing. He's rubbished by his family and contemporaries. He's ostracized. He's the youngest of eight brothers and he has a sister. He is a total non-entity in the family. He does not rate. It's quite remarkable. Whenever anybody said to Jesse, one of your boys, if they wanted one for this job or one for that job, for instance, Saul said, Jesse, send me the boy who's with the sheep. That was his title, the boy who's with the sheep. That's all he's good for. To look after a few sheep, he can't hurt them or damage them. That's his level in life. He's reached his level. He'll never step up above that level. I never forget the Sunday night, I stood up in my home church and said, God has called me into the ministry. The senior elder said, Sonny, go down the coal mines. That's your level. Hallelujah. That's what he said. That's your level in life. Don't try to rise above it. That is your level. But friends, if God has intended for your life to rise above whatever level is imposed upon you or accepted by you mentally and psychologically because of people's criticism or their estimation of you, if God has intended for you to burst that boundary, then you better breach that dam and go through that wall, and you better do it quickly. Now, as I read these Davidic Psalms, I find that David bears his soul. And his life is a constant battle against negative emotions. You know, just like you are facing in life. Even when he knew the purposes and calling of God, there were myriads of negative emotions conspiring against his destiny in God. He bears his soul in these Psalms. And he tells you, I'm afraid of living. I'm afraid of dying. I'm afraid of today. I'm afraid of tomorrow. I'm afraid to go to bed. I cry all night. I'm worn out with my sorrows. I'm afraid to get up to battle with pain and hurts and rejection and depression and inadequacies. In Psalm 13, verse 2, he crystallizes his thinking. How long must I wrestle with my thoughts and every day have sorrow in my heart? And he reaches the depth of despair in Psalm 22 and verse 6 when he says, to God, our fathers trusted in you and were delivered, and they were not disappointed, but I am a worm. You can't get lower than a worm. And I'm amazed at Pentecostals who say, I'm nobody, I'm no good, I'm a worm. God made you in his own image, and God doesn't look like a worm. But you are a founder member of the Pity Me Club, as David was. He paid up his subscriptions. He was a lifelong member of the club. Pity me. If you knew what I'm going through, if you knew the problems I'm having with you and my husband, God bless you. Most wives have problems with their husbands. Unless you're a pastor. And then, believe me, you would be in the club. But I am a worm. That's why you're not delivering me. That's why I'm disappointed. That's why I'm hurt. That's why I am feeling so shocked to pieces with rejection and inadequacies and abuse. I'm nothing. All of this unnerved this young man and made him a nervous wreck. He would have been the answer to a psychiatrist's dream. He would have become a millionaire with David on his couch. He had such low self-esteem. These devastating negative forces, these ghosts from the past, were pressurizing him to yield to ordinariness and mediocrity and to live his life at the bottom of the ladder and watch others climb the ladder of success. And here am I at the bottom. I'm the bottom of the pile. Had David yielded to these negative emotions? Had he not learned how to break free from this bondage, he would have lived an insignificant life, in total obscurity, in a small village, in a dead-end job, looking after a few sheep. That he made it to the top when the odds were so stacked against him is an eloquent testimony and an encouragement to each of us tonight that there is a greater force than genetics or environment that can lift us up above the vortex and the grip of abuse and hurts. I love the Lord Jesus saying to his disciples, they have just understood he's going to leave them and they feel like orphans. And there is no pain in the world like being left an orphan when you're a babe. And Jesus said, I'm not leaving you as orphans. I'm sending you the Holy Spirit. Do you know that's a profound statement? See, if you brought up an orphan, oh, you are a target for negative forces, rejection. You live an antisocial life because of this volcano of insecurity that constantly erupts within you. But Jesus is saying, my disciples should not be victims of negative emotions. I will not leave you as orphans. I will send you the Holy Spirit, and he will guide you into all truth. Not just theological truth, but truth about who you are in Christ. That smashes the devastating delusions of the devil. He will guide you into all truth. He adopts us. What a wonderful family of love you and I have been adopted into. There's not one of us here tonight who can say, well, you know, I had such a terrible upbringing. No wonder I am such as I am, a negative force in the assembly. I'm always looking on the dark side, you know. If you hadn't had bread and butter on the table like I had, we didn't have shoes. We only had cardboard, you know. God in heaven help us. You and I have been adopted into a wonderful family with the Holy Spirit as the head of it. And all the love and affection that we ever need to counteract whatever we've gone through is ours if we walk in the light. Now, the exciting thing to me as I read these Davidic Psalms was that when David is baring his soul and exposing his nerves, it doesn't stop there. Immediately, he switches from, but I'm a worm, and I'm breaking my heart with sorrow. Then he swings and says, I will lift up mine eyes to the hill from whence comes my help. I will sing of the mercies of the Lord. Why are you cast down, O my soul? And he takes off his eyes off his feelings of rejection and hurt, and he dwells on God. And it's only when you come into the New Testament that you fully grasp what is happening. When you go into the New Testament, many of these counteracting scriptures of David that he recites when he's really going through the doldrums. In the New Testament writers say, the Holy Spirit spoke through the mouth of David. Are you getting what I'm saying? These things that he was saying, he was learning psychology without paying out a psychologist. He surely came to the place where he thought, well, bless me, if I just think negatively every day, I'm never going to be anything other than a caretaker of a few sheep. And it's when he becomes positive, the New Testament interprets it as the Holy Spirit spoke through the mouth of his servant David. And so we can say that the way to break free from the clutch of that which demeans and inhibits you and which makes your circle small in life is to have fellowship with the Holy Spirit. In 2 Corinthians, there is a verse, it's the very last verse of the second epistle. We quote it very often in our benedictions on Sunday. We don't grasp its significance. Now may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God the Father, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit. How many of us have fellowshipped with the Holy Spirit today? Tell me. We sing about him. I'm not talking about that. I mean fellowship with the Holy Spirit. You have a chat with him. I do very often. Every time I get up to preach, I say, now if you don't come and stand by my side, I might as well not get up. Tell the convener to keep on singing, because without you, I'm no good. I will ever be grateful to the Holy Spirit when I became a Christian. So shy, so introspective. Oh, such low self-esteem, a nervous wreck. Couldn't say 2 words to 2 people without blushing. And God had mucked it all up by calling me into the ministry. And he... Well, I now know it was the Holy Spirit. It took me a long time to understand, many, many years. I'd go to bed at night and I thought there were nightmares. I would dream of preaching in churches with thousands of people there. And I thought, that's vanity. Tonight, no cheese and pickled onions before going to bed. It made no difference. The crowd was bigger. So I said, right, no cocoa tonight. The crowd grew bigger. What was happening was the Holy Spirit was destroying the only model of the church I had, that small little church in that little village. And he was saying, if you remain in the grips of negative emotions, you can stay in that small circle. But if you fellowship with me, I'll break the boundaries down. Fellowship with the Holy Spirit. I tell you, it's marvelous. And we preachers need that more than anybody. When we're leading meetings, when we're preaching, to have a sensitive ear to he that really matters. Little did the neighbors think, as that little lad, Lieutenant Eliab, going out one door with Major, what was the name of the second guy? Oh, let me not ask the fountainheads of wisdom in the Assemblies of God. How should I expect them to know if I can't remember? I did until I came to Prestatyn, I knew. But then the Ely Mora disappeared. Doesn't matter. One of them was a lieutenant, one of them was a major, and the other one was a warrant officer in Saul's army, and they went spick and span in their uniform, brass buckles shining, boots. You could see your face in the boots. They went out one door, and David went out the back door with his knapsack on his back, his sandwiches, his bow and arrow, and his sling. Dirty clothes, he was only going to look after a few dirty sheep. And as he went down the road towards the desert where the sheep were, and he was whistling a tune, little did the neighbors think, one day, that man will write the world's number one best song. Sung at coronations all over the world, royal weddings, royal funerals, state occasions. That's why I asked Brother Morgan to read tonight that 23rd Psalm. They thought, what can the village idiot do? The village idiot, when God steps into his life, my friends, can rise to the very top. And I'm looking at a few tonight. Except you may be the town, non-entity, or the city, non-entity. Rejoice, your night has come, my friends. It has come. Ah, he's nothing, they thought. There are the good ones going up the other way to the army. And there's the nothing, good for nothing, going. Who would have believed that in a few short years he would be the most quoted of the Old Testament characters, the one who saw Jesus most clearly thousands of years before he came? No one had greater encounters with the Holy Spirit than this one. He would become the benchmark for every king in Israel and Judah. They would say he lived like his father David, or he did not live like. He was the benchmark. Everything was measured. The effectiveness of the king's rule was measured by this man, the village idiot. Rubbished, ridiculed, odd, of no consequence. But God had earmarked him for greatness. And if so, my friends, anybody else's opinion is obsolete. It doesn't matter what they think of you, unless you deserve it. If you feel you're victimized, I'm not accepted, my giftings are not realized, what does it matter? If God has earmarked you to be a great evangelist or a great missionary or a pastor, teacher, prophet, apostle, it's time you shook off what they think about you and just surrender to the one who has said, you are meant for greatness. Now the Spirit of God has left Saul, and the prophet Samuel is moping. He says, now the kingdom will fall to bits, just like, you know, when the successful pastor leaves. The elders think, oh, what's going to happen now? The pastor's gone. The place will fall to pieces. And God says to Samuel, dry up, shut up, and get up. You can't see that in your Bible. You've got to have a red Bible. It says an awful lot more than those black ones some of you got. And the Lord said to Samuel, get the horn of oil. And he says, put on a barbecue in Bethlehem. Invite the elders. Well, they'll always go for a free meal anyway, the elders. Especially if the pastor's paying. And Samuel, God said to him, send an invitation card to Jesse and all his sons, because it's one of them that's going to be the new king. Can you imagine that barbecue? There's what was Eliab, a lieutenant. Then Major Abinadab and the other guy. Sham, that's him. Full. He was a sham too. Full of wind. They're there in full army uniform. They looked like warriors. They looked like leaders. They looked like prospective kings. And when the first one, when Jesse said, this is the oldest one, Samuel said, this is he. He looks like a leader. He looks like a soldier. Friends, any fool can look like a soldier when there's no war on. That's what drives me scatty in Pentecostal churches. We talk about spiritual warfare. What? Who are we kidding? Some Christians have bound the devil Millions of times, he's still loose. If I were you, I'd shut up. Don't bind him anymore. It's not working. They plead the blood, plead the blood, plead the blood. My friends, he's not impressed with that. The kingdom of Satan has not been dented 1 millimeter by most Pentecostals. But ma, you go into the assembly and the way they sing, you'd think this is great. The devil's trembling. The devil says, they're insignificant, they don't mean it. They only sing about it. They sing about it on Sunday, on Monday, they'll have forgotten all about it. They'll be normal on Monday. God help us. Oh, Samuel thought, this is he. He took the top off the anointing bottle. He looks just like Saul. Nobody will miss Saul because he looks like him. And the Lord says, pass him by. God, he's the best. You can't afford to pass him by, the Lord says. He looks like a soldier, but he hasn't got the guts for battle. He's only dressed like one. He's a weak one. Seven times, no, 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 no. Until Samuel thought, God in heaven, I'm the prophet, and I've got my revelation wrong. I'll have to go to Ealing Bible College and get it right. You will edit some of those things, won't you? Whatever. The prophet was scared stiff. I've got my revelation wrong for the first time. Do you have any more sons, Jesse? Oh, I love the reply. Yes, but if I were you, I'd line these up again and use my glasses or take the editor's glasses. Hallelujah. Now, Samuel, oh my word, he's 10 foot tall now. These glasses have got the gift of exaggeration. No wonder he couldn't score against us when he was playing cricket. No, Jesse said, line these up again. He is no good. Let me tell you, if I tell you, Samuel, that right now he's looking after a few dozen sheep, that tells you everything, doesn't it? That's his level. Don't disturb him. Don't bother him. He's happy. You should have heard him whistling a tune this morning about the Lord's my shepherd, I'll not want. Not want? No, he had half a dozen sandwiches in his pocket. He makes me down to lies, and I hope he doesn't lie too much. I hope he's looking after those sheep. That's all he's good for. And if he fails there, then he's got nothing else he can touch his hands with. He's hopeless. Get him. Yes, but he is only a shepherd. Get him. And when 2 hours later this ruddy-faced little fellow came in, smelling of sheep number one, Samuel thought, oh, God. He says, thank God I'm almost retiring as a prophet. Things are getting worse. God says, you look on the outward. You thought Eliab, Abinadab, and that sham guy. You thought that's them. And you say, ha ha, that's not him. See, but I have read his heart. God saw inside that poet, that musician, that shepherd, that innocent, fresh-looking young boy. God saw the man of war. And he said, pour the oil on him. Pour the oil on him. Lord, I'm not in. It doesn't matter whether you're impressed, Samuel. You do it. Now, let me tell you, this is fantastic. Oh, I covet this for you here tonight. You know, I've noticed in the Bible that whenever anybody had sandwiches with him, it was dangerous. Remember that little boy? Must have been in the school holidays. His mother buttered 5 rolls and then opened a tin of John West sardines and wrapped it up in greaseproof paper and said, "Skedaddle, don't come back till 5 o'clock tonight." Well, he came back at 9. It's in the red Bible. She said, "Where have you been?" She was about a... "Mother," he said, "do you know today, you won't believe this." Sure enough, she didn't. "Do you know those rolls you gave me and those little sardines? Well, you know, a man came and said, will you lend me those? Because see that man there, that's Jesus. He'd like to have them. And he's going to feed. Do you know what, Mother? He took those 5 loaves and he just lifted them up and said, Father, bless these. 5,000 men, apart from the women and children, ate my sandwiches." Boom! She clipped him across the ear. "Said, I've taught you not to lie." I said, "But Mother, it's true." "Well, here's David." Father said, "Well, I think I can trust you to take some sandwiches up to your brothers who are in the battle. Just take a few sandwiches up." And he takes a few sandwiches up. And the father said, "See how the battle is going. I'm sure those boys of mine have killed a few Philistines by now. Bring back some spoils of war, some tokens. Ask Eliab and Abinadab and Sham." "Your father would like to have a Philistine helmet from each of you. When you stood on that Philistine with your foot on his neck and chopped his head off, he wants to hang those Philistine helmets in the living room. Bring them back." But when David got up to where the battle should have been, there were no Red Cross tents, no doctors and nurses, no blood, no injured. He thought, "Where's the battle?" And his 3 brothers wouldn't answer him. They said, "You nosy Parker, what are you doing here? You've come to see the battle." He could have said, "What battle? Where is the war?" Right then, the bugle sounded, and out came a few thousand Israeli soldiers, dressed like soldiers, impressive, with gleaming swords, and they ran towards the battle line and present arms. No, they didn't have rifles in those days. They couldn't afford them. They had swords. "About turn!" And then they ran towards the battle line. They were clever beggars, though. When they got to cowardice line, they stopped there. You see, up till there, they were safe. They could pretend to be soldiers playing at war. The moment they stepped over that line, it was real war. They sang the battle song. "We're going to take this land for Jesus." Do they sing that in AOG churches? Wish I could burn that song and the writer, whoever he was. There's nothing wrong with what he's written. But oh, just like these thought they were being soldiers. For 40 days they go through this meaningless charade. And Sunday by Sunday we come to church and we say, "We're going to take this land for Jesus." We haven't taken one enemy soldier prisoner yet. Most of us here have never won one person to Christ. But we're singing, "We're going to take this land for Jesus, be bold." And then duck under the first time there's a chance to win somebody to Christ. You might as well sing, "Be Percil, be Omar, be Ariel, be Daz." As "be bold." You're not as quick as they are in healing. What's the point of singing about being bold if we're not bold? What's the point of singing about being soldiers if we are not taking prisoners? We are pretending. And the height of ignominy was when Goliath stood up and says, "What in the world are you doing coming up against me like that and then not fighting?" Now, I'm sure the devil says, "What in the blessed word are you Pentecostals doing in church every Sunday? Just singing about it." God help us, friends. Singing about it, and we think because we sing about it, we're doing it. My brothers won't tell me, "Young fellow, tell me what's going on. What's going on?" And the young fellow told him, "This has been going on for 40 days. Nobody has guts to take on the enemy. Great men were silent. Saul was in his tent. Jonathan was in his tent. The great leaders were not leading the people, but allowing them to be hypocrites." The young man said, "You know, 2 weeks ago, Saul was so desperate, he put an offer out. Anybody who goes over there, leads the people into war, and takes that giant and the army, I'll make him a millionaire." David said, "You mean nobody took that offer on?" "No. Last week," he said, "anybody who leads the troops to fight against the Philistines, he'll have my daughter Michael as his wife. And do you know what?" he said, "today, he's just put a notice up, an advert, special offer, 3 for the price of 1. A millionaire, my daughter Michael, and his family will never have to pay income tax again." David says, "That's it, thank you. That's it. No more on Her Majesty's services on the envelopes. I better get rid of that, otherwise I might slide towards the battlefield too." David says, "That's it." Now, listen. Why didn't David keep his nose clean and go home? He'd done his job. The only thing he hadn't done was he didn't have the helmets of 3 Philistines soldiers to take home to his dad. He'd be disappointed, but go home, son. If these can't do it, what do you think you are? Leave well alone. Leave it alone. Can you remember when Peter and John came out on bail? The magistrate says, "Don't you ever mention the name of Jesus again. Otherwise, you'll be back in the cooler. Long stretch. No bread, no water." They go back to the prayer meeting and they said, "Rejoice with us that we've been imprisoned, suffering for his name." And then Peter quotes David in the Old Testament. "Do they think we are going to be intimidated by their threats?" he says. "Why should the heathen rage?" I know that not even the Red Bible I can point with certainty, but I'm trying to piece it together. I know of no other similar occasion, but that this young boy who only had communion and fellowship with the Holy Spirit to bolster him and to keep his morale up, and to stop him from sinking in the whirlpool of negative emotions. When he heard Goliath say, "Challenge you." And they said, "He's insulting Israel." David says, "No, he's not insulting Israel. He's insulting God. Why should the heathen rage against God? How can I go home to the sheep when that man has been doing that for 40 days and nobody's had the guts to have a go at him? Why should the heathen rage?" And so, my friends, it became an act of faith and not presumption. The Holy Spirit was stirring him up. I tell you, the sin merchants. Yes, they're corrupting and polluting our young people. But it is an insult to Almighty God. Not just to humanity and decency. And the church still sings, we're going to take this land for Jesus. Hallelujah. Now, I like aerobics. The doctor told me, you've got to move, Wynne. And so, why not move in church? It's free there. If you go to a health club, you've got to pay. So, I have my aerobics in church. But I'm conscious, friends, that this is doing me as much good physically as spiritually, perhaps more. It's no indication of whether I'm fellowshipping with the Holy Spirit or responding to his challenges. Go home, laddie. Why should that heathen rage? Oh, I like him. I like him. When you read the story carefully, he goes down, hitches his trousers up because mine needs hitching up. And he picks 5 stones up from the brook. If I had been him, I would have kept one of those in my hand. But he puts them in his pouch. Do you know, why do they put so many pockets in a man's suit? Can never find my keys, can never find money. When I come to immigration, can never find the passport. Oh, bless my soul. People's muttering behind you while I'm looking through all my pockets. And if I had been David, I would have kept one of those stones in my hand in case he couldn't find it when the giant advanced on him. But he puts it nonchalantly in his pocket and his sling somewhere else. And I think if I had been walking towards an assignment I'd never had before, I would have not only had measured footsteps, but small ones. I would have been pleading everything. But this young man, only good enough to look after a few sheep, runs towards him. And when you read the declarations of faith, the prophetic utterances, he says, you're as good as dead. You might as well lie down now, because that's where you're going to end. And what a beautiful story. Now, it's 2 o'clock the next morning. Jesse is wondering, that blessed boy of mine, that stupid David, can't even trust him to take a few sandwiches up and to bring back 3 helmets. It's 2 o'clock in the morning, no sign of him coming. And he's pacing up and down in that little cottage in Bethlehem. I said, man, I'll wring his neck. I've had to pay that other shepherd treble time to look after those sheep because of his stupidity. And then at 2 o'clock in the morning, and he says, where? What are you perspiring like that for? Where have you been? He says, Father, you won't believe this. David says, before you shout at me, Father, come out here. This is what's kept me late. So I've dragged this all the way home. He says, look, that's the size, but I didn't touch that one there. These are little swords. These are for midgets. He says, look at this. Where are the 3 Philistine helmets that my boys? No. David says, you are Eliab, Abinadab, and Sham is a great sham. He is. He's a great sham. They have never been in a battle. Don't say lies. Father, that's true. What is that sword? That's Goliath's sword. How did you get it? I used it to chop his head off. Listen, son, are you on drugs? You are hallucinating. Come in and have some cocoa. They didn't have tea. Tea sorted all out in Britain. A cup of tea brings you to sanity. And while he was having his cocoa, for the 12th time, Jesse says, son, are you telling me the truth? He says, Father, if you'll pay that man double time again and look after the sheep tomorrow, I'll take you up. I'll take you up where they're dismantling the tents now because the war is over. It's over. And God used me.
David. Jesse says, I can't believe that. But it doesn't matter whether they believe it or not. It doesn't matter. And you know, I can see with the eye of faith tonight some of you, and according to other people, you've reached your level in the assembly. We just about trust you to give out, well, you don't give out hymn books anymore, don't you? To handle the acetates. And you're not doing that too well either. You get them all jumbled up. They may have decreed that you're at the level. There are deacons here tonight. My friends, you're going to go through the next barrier. Because never mind democracy. I'm doing a seminar on anti-democracy later in the week. Just in time, just before. Is the Lord giving me a revelation before Thursday? Ah, well, you wouldn't know, would you, unless you delegate. Unless you are also moving in revelation gifts. Forgive my wickedness. What I'm saying is this, my friends. If God, when you came into the world, said about you, it was intended, it's time you carried out his intentions. If God says for this purpose, brought I this boy or girl into the world, you better find out his purpose. Don't live a narrow life, a small life, a mediocre life, when God has destined you for greatness. That's not to blow your brains and make you haughty and proud, not at all. Amazing thing is this, that long after Samuel poured the oil on David, he still continued being a shepherd boy, and occasional excursions and incursions to the king's palace. You see, God wanted people to see he had a servant spirit. He's had the oil on him, but his hair hasn't grown any bigger. Can't stand anybody in God's work who hasn't got a servant spirit. We are where we are, my friends, only because of the grace of God and the anointing of the Holy Spirit. Without that, we are nothing. But I refuse to be nothing when the Holy Spirit says, I am with you. Amen. To help you achieve the purposes of God for your generation. And when you and I come to that place, then the other verse might be applicable to us. God might say, my servant so-and-so, they will do everything I want them to do. And I'm learning, yes, rather late in life, my friends, that there are no boundaries with God, no barriers. God can break through every barrier. If you allow God to be God and not impose your puny mind upon him, and you don't confine him to your understanding of him and his operations, but you say, let God be God. The world is your oyster. It is. He is looking for men and women tonight who are so pliable and flexible and so open that they believe that they are men and women of destiny in God. I want to pray for you. Let's pray. Without any fuss, any pleading, I'm asking God right now for a certain number of people. On Thursday night in our conference, I asked God for 100 men and women who would leave their jobs and come to work for him full time because they believed this was God's destiny. 300 responded. Now, God hasn't given me any number for you, but I know that there are choice people here tonight. I want you to have your heads bowed and close your eyes. I want you to have fellowship with the Holy Spirit right now. You cannot do anything out of presumption. No man, when the writer to the Hebrews says about the priesthood, no man can take this upon himself.
No, no. But on the other hand, my friends, if God has called you into his ministry, how dare you stay in your comfortable job with financial ease and comfort if God has called you to be a man or a woman of destiny? I want all those who say, Wynne Lewis, I see myself in David. I'm battling with low esteem. I'm battling with other negative emotions. People saying you're no good. I'm believing them. Then it's time you believe the Holy Spirit tonight. I want you to come out. If you're saying, I am responding tonight and I'm willing to go where he sends me. I'm willing to go into full-time service. I'm willing to be trained for full-time service. Then come and stand at the front here and come down and pray for you. Quickly, leave your seats and come. I didn't just call young people. It's a fallacy to believe that once you've gone 50, you're past it. Most of us, my friends, never got alive until we were 50 in God's things. I don't care how old you are. I don't care how young you are either. Come, I'm waiting. Fields are white unto harvest. There are a few more laborers coming tonight. You understand what I meant? Some of you may have to leave a comfortable lifestyle, a beautiful financial cushion. You've got no problems now, but your problems begin tonight. But you'll be happy even when you're up to your neck in problems, because you know this is God's intention for me. You can stand before Roman governors or anybody and you can say, for this purpose came I into the world. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I'm waiting a few moments. I wonder, pastors here, would you go down? And when in a moment we begin to pray, any pastors in the congregation, and the spirit of faith is upon you. I don't want these people, if you haven't got faith, stay where you are. If you want these to be at your level, stay where you are. I don't want any more singing evangelists who will just sing about the battle, who will just sing about taking Britain for Jesus. I want people tonight who will say, I will take Britain for Christ. I will begin by winning my neighbors, my workmates, my family to Jesus Christ. That's what the battle is, not singing about it. There are a couple more to come, my friends. There's a young couple here. You're married. And you thought you had such a comfortable lifestyle and everything. You've got it planned right up to retirement. And now God has come in to mess it all up tonight. Praise God for God's messing up. I want you to come wherever you are, that young couple, quickly. You have the right not to come. But I plead with you tonight to come and join this crowd. I'm waiting. That doesn't mean to say there are only two. There's still time. I'm glad that some of you are counting the cost. You'll never be happy. You might become the richest person in your town or city. You'll never be happy. And to come to the end of your life, what in the world is that money in the bank worth? It's valueless currency where we are going, friends. Valueless currency. Thank you. Now, pastors, if you are full of faith, you can only lay hands on people if your experience of God, I believe, is greater than the ones you're praying for. If your heart is burning for Jesus, if you're fellowshipping with the Holy Spirit, and you can impart something to these tonight, then come and join us in praying for them right now. Let's sing one verse a couple of times, maybe, of "Here I am, wholly available," and then we'll start praying. "As for me, I will serve the Lord. The fields are white unto harvest. Lord, the laborers are few," and there's still a few more coming. Praise God for that. "Here I am, holy." Sing it very softly. And you pray for these friends. Right? More than praying for you, we are commissioning you tonight to the harvest.
Holy harvest.
I want these being prayed for to stay here. I want you in the congregation to stand and stretch your hands forth. And you commission them as well to the harvest. Shagamarana, play softly. Make them flaming swords, O God. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah.
I'm
going to ask him in a moment to follow you, David. Has everybody been prayed for down here? Would you look at me then, please? Once the prayer is finished, just look at me for a moment. When God finally convinced me that I was called to the ministry, I tell you, if I had started working for him then, I would have torn everything to shreds. I had to learn a lot. I'm still learning. I don't believe that any of us should take ignorance into the work of God. The Bible tells us to study, to show yourself approved unto God, a workman that needeth not to be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. And I would like to think that each of you, if you've got the faith tonight to believe that you're about to realize your destiny, that come this new academic year in Mattersea, that you will have enrolled. Now, I believe that. Don't want anybody to say, well, now I'm going to realize my destiny. Hold on. You might come a cropper if you don't have character to go with calling. And character can only be tested, I believe, when we go to a place like a Bible school. Not saying you can't serve God without going there. But there, if you don't know how to live with people of other cultures and people who are not of your assembly and get used to them, how can you manage the work of God with diverse viewpoints and personalities? It's a great place to shape and mold. And I want you now to follow Pastor Petz, the principal of Mattersea, over to the Bible school stand, and he's got something exciting to give you. You believe that?
Yes,
he has, an enrollment form. Are you young enough to jump down there, David? Whoop! Will you follow him now and go with him across there, please? We haven't got a room here. Just turn that way. Right turn. You're in the army now. Present arms. Over to the battlefield, to the tents. Amen. Whoa, I tell you, I'm just starting. You know, last week we had a fellow, Shambach, not the third son of Jesse, an American preacher, and he preached for 2.5 hours each night. So I think I can take my jacket off and start again. No, I won't frighten you. Where are you going that way? Hey, this way. This is where the battle is. Come on. Quickly. Are you joining Ealing Bible College there? Right, you can sit down for a moment. That's right, keep coming. God bless you, friends. Oh, in every meeting like this, there is tremendous potential for God to turn the world upside down. Hallelujah. Turn the world upside down. God bless you, friends, and I'm going to hand back to the convener. Thank Amen. You.
Can you hear me? Yes. I wouldn't have missed tonight for anything. But you know, and I'm beating my breast in penitence, I miss the singer. But he's going to minister to us in song, graciously consented to do this, and I'm sure he's going to bless us as he exalts the name of Jesus.
I thank God for bringing me to a crossroads that I might choose to serve him full time. And thank God for all of these tonight. I choose Jesus. Praise you, Lord. Glory to you, Father. Thank you, Jesus. Some say life is just a series of decisions. We make choices, we live and learn. Now I'm standing at a crossroad, and I must choose which way to turn. Down the one road lies all the world can offer.
its power, its wealth and fame. Down the other, just a man with nail scars in his hands. But there's mercy in his eyes, and there's power in his name. I choose Jesus, I choose Jesus, without a solitary doubt. I choose Jesus, not for miracles, but for loving me. Not for Bethlehem, but for Calvary. Not for a day, but for eternity. I choose Jesus.
Unto you, Lord, forever and ever, and unto the Lamb. Hallelujah.
If I could, I'd put my hand on his shoulder and thank him. Let's just stand to bless the Lord together. We thank you, Lord, that as we commit our lives to you, everything fits together and works together so beautifully and so smoothly. And we thank you for the privilege of being here. We thank you that we didn't have to bring you down or call you up, but you are present with us. We pray now as we go our separate ways, you'll continue to bless us. We pray for those who even now are considering their futures, that they shall affirm the right decision. And should you tarry, that they shall become pillars of your church. We pray, Lord, make us happy, make us holy, but above all, by your Spirit, make us effective. And this we ask with every blessing in the name of Jesus. And all God's people said, Amen. God bless you. Thank you for coming.